thje.tv is extremely, extremely proud to partner with Times Litfest Mumbai for this spectacular conversation on daughters in the boardroom. As we know, we have an imminent panel, and I'm very excited to chat with all of you. And before we start, I just want to let you know that, you know, we encourage you to tweet during this session. So please use the hashtag Times Litfest, and our handle is at shethepeople.tv. So now, without further ado, let's start talking, ladies. So, you know, my first question to all of you is, as daughters in the boardroom, you've all managed to create your own legacies. You know, you all took ideas that your fathers had and you've sort of built it up. So how has it been a difficult journey? We'll start with you, Lara, and, you know, you can, you know, take us through your journey so far.
Okay, I'm not so sure it's been a difficult journey. I guess everyone has their difficulties and challenges. But I think what, looking back now that I've been working for 12 years, I feel really old. What really helped me was when I started out at Madison, I started out as a management trainee. So I wasn't at this position right from day one. I worked my way up to the top. So I think that's given me a really strong foundation. And today I feel I'm just a lot more a stronger person, and I'm able to deal with a lot more challenges that come my way because of the strong foundation. So, I mean, otherwise difficulties and challenges everyone faces in day-to-day life and at work.
Over to you, Ashni, if you could take us through your journey.
I think just talking.
Yeah.
My journey was interesting because I studied design, and I was not studying design with the end objective to be a part of Future Group in any considerable way, perhaps. So my journey was, you know, from design to the world of business. There was a good exchange. There has been a great exchange between design and business in this journey. I found myself not so challenged, perhaps similar to what Lara said, because I think I grew up in the angan of the store, if I may say so. So I grew up spending holidays hanging merchandise on stores, sweeping the stores when they were opening. You know, I was very much a part of the retail ecosystem, and in the consumer business, once you understand the customer, then, you know, you've gained your place in there. So I think I gained my place through an insight and understanding that I had about customers, India, and the market. So it's been interesting, challenging in its own ways, but I won't say it's difficult.
And Amira, we'd love to know your journey as well.
So I think my journey has actually been very challenging. Glad to hear you guys have sort of really gone through it much better than me, probably. You know, my story was really that I came back to India after I did my undergrad in the US in 2001. And my father and my mom are both doctors and professionals, and they've always just worked hard, been very sort of straight-jacketed, very, very commitment sort of centric, done everything the right way, no black money in our house. So I came back to that family that I'd grown up in, and I saw that my father had built his pathology lab successfully in South Bombay, and my mother had her practice. And the idea I had in 2001 was to say that, look, why can't I really make this into a chain of laboratories that stands for a brand that's away from an individual, but it's actually corporatized, and can really stand for best practices that are available globally, not what was available in India in 2001. And how do we really make the patient comfortable? How do we be empathetic? And how do we provide quality that doesn't exist in India today? And that's how I really started building, you know, sort of building the chain of labs and my journey. I changed the name to Metropolis from Dr. Sushil Shah's lab to Metropolis in 2001, and then started the journey. Not growing up actually in a business family is, you know, I grew up knowing a lot of doctors because that's what my parents' friends were. Coming from a non-medical background myself, to fit into the medical world was a bit of a challenge. But I think the bigger challenge was when you don't come from a business family, you've got to pretty much navigate the ropes yourself. So be it difficult partnerships, be it difficult shareholding, be it, you know, where does the money come from, how do you grow? And I think that journey and the difficulties around that I think were quite a lot. I think in the last 16 years, it's been nothing but fun. It's been a crazy roller coaster ride, but one that's been really satisfying and enjoyable every step of the way. Because literally, I remember having, you know, 35 employees in 2001, and today we have 4,000. And I look back and I've pretty much handpicked the top 200 or 300. And I think that's a very satisfying feeling. So I think despite the challenges, it's been a great journey.
And, you know, I think we need to celebrate the fact that, you know, each of you has had this desire to sort of break boundaries and to sort of do something new and something different. So, you know, can you take us through that, you know, just what sparked the idea to sort of change things around in the business? So we'll start with Lara.
So Madison was more a typical ad agency, and about 12 years ago, so when I got involved in the business, the whole definition of advertising was changing, and today anything and everything is advertising. So what we did was we started diversifying into newer areas, what we weren't in, like outdoor and rural and retail, and there were so many other things. And so the whole idea was to reposition the company not just as an advertising and a media company, but as a comprehensive communication solution provider to any client. So irrespective of what need a client has, we have specialist units to offer the client what they need. So that was the whole idea and the genesis of how Madison World as a group and a brand came into play.
You know, Ashni, if you could take us through
yours. So at the larger group level, I think, you know, my role has been quite fundamental in shaping the culture of the organization, whether it's been around bringing design thinking into the organization, getting people to think customers first in the organization. So a lot of the work has been around that. The challenges have been around converting larger Big Bazaar stores from super centers, as they were known, to a more to a family center, to a more community destination. Open the 11th Big Bazaar store and still ensure you have queues outside. I think so. That's been the journey to take everyone along while one is trying to make any change in the organization. I think in a consumer business we have to keep responding. So there's not one particular thing, but there are multiple. One thing that, you know, perhaps we've been able to do well, and maybe I have a deeper contribution in it, has been, my father always said that there are three things that drive consumption. One is greed, the other is fear, and the third is altruism. While this was very well articulated, no one knew what to do with altruism. So what one did was, one actually created various rituals around which we would serve the customers in our stores. And we actually created an entire program called Seva. Many of the stores in smaller towns, in cities like Mysore, completely came afresh because we used to serve, cook food in our stores, serve by our own hands to customers once every month. And this practice changed the fate of the store in the cities. And then it got scaled up across the country.
And the rest, as they say, is history. So, Amira, I know you've said that you actually had a very hands-on approach to sort of taking the company to where it is. So can you sort of take us through, you know, how you decided to sort of do that?
So, you know, when I came back in 2001, as I mentioned, it was a sort of a single lab. And I think what the lab was doing very well was good quality. Patients recognized that we gave 100% correct blood reports, which nobody else did. And there was that reputation based on it. But to take a sole proprietorship and to convert it into an organization requires multiple things, right? It requires a team. It requires a change of processes where it's not one man or one woman making decisions, but it's actually a corporate and people making decisions and having the processes and SOPs around it. It requires capital. It requires expansion. It requires risk-taking. And so I think, you know, what I was very fortunate for was that there was no company before I came in. So I was very fortunate because I think sometimes when you're trying to step in other people's shoes, actually it's much more of a challenge. And sometimes when you're actually trying to make something from an early stage, it's sometimes easier. So there were some legacy issues because there were already employees, and like you said, carrying people along and changing mindsets is always hard. But I think the biggest change was having the vision that this could exist and then building it.
And, you know, as young women, you know, less than 30 or in your 30s, really, you know, has gender ever really come in the way of working? You know, whoever wants to take that first.
I think I've been really fortunate because of the industry that I'm in, like in advertising and communications, it's advantageous to be a woman. So I have absolutely faced no inequality against me or any such thing. But I guess I'm lucky and the industry is very pro-women. It may be different in different, in the banking industry or some other industries.
I think I made sure gender didn't come in the way. I think we as women have to work hard to make sure gender doesn't come in the way. Otherwise, anything can come in the way, not just gender. Age can come in the way. The fact that you come from your father's daughter can come in the way. So you just have to pave your way around that and focus on the work. I think, in fact, in my context, because it's a consumer-focused environment, we can add lots more as women. You know, we always refer to women as she. And, you know, I guess we as women are far more empathetic. We listen more. So for us, actually, it's more advantageous. It's definitely harder physically because there are long hours on the floor and it's a cumbersome role to play. But, you know, at the end of it, the joy you get in touching the millions of lives that you do takes everything else away.
Again, slight difference of opinion, but I think it's very hard for most women. I think the challenges are deep conditioning. I think from a very young age, especially in countries like India and emerging markets, there's a very deep conditioning on how you see women, how you see men, and therefore the role of a woman and her in home, at her work. I remember so many incidences. I mean, I remember from the time when I was 21 and I would approach other pathology labs, people who were 65 years old, and I was sitting across the table and talking to them about acquiring their business. And for them, it was a shocker. One, that I was a woman. Second, I was 21. And they're like, who's this young girl who's like not even, you know, like our daughter's age, who's talking about buying my business from her? And it was unacceptable for them. They had a really hard time dealing with it. And so I had to change the way I approached it to make it more acceptable and soften my approach a lot to really become their daughters and then talk about a partnership rather than talking about an acquisition and build that emotional relationship with them that it wasn't a threatening situation. Or the time when I was raising private equity in 2005, and I remember the five funds that I was talking to, at least three of them asking me, in some indirect or direct way, that, listen, you know, you're now 20-something and you'll probably get married. Are you going to continue running this business? And it, to me, it was just a ridiculous question because if I was a guy, they would have never asked me that question because it's normal for a man to continue running his business. And that's what I told them. I said, look, this is my baby. Where do you think I'm going to go? I mean, I've built this and I can't just dump it and walk away. It's not an option. The fact that it took that much convincing and that I had to really stake my claim in the ground and convince them, I think shows that there is deep sexism. And I see it even today, by the way. Just last year, I was in Mauritius talking to, we're in a few countries and talking to a potential consulting firm partner, right? Now, consulting firms usually have very educated, exposed people working with them. And I was with my general manager who was sitting with us and this partner. And the partner wouldn't look at me. He just couldn't look at me. The entire time he would spend talking, looking at the general manager. Because when I would ask him a question, he would turn to the GM and he would talk to him. And these are things which I see regularly happening. I don't know, maybe some of it is maybe industry. I think some of it is the kind of, experiences each of us have had.
So actually, you know, you've already sort of touched on it, but, you know, I know you said you didn't face a lot of that, but did you face any resistance? Is there any example that, you know, that comes to mind when you sort of joined the company? Any resistance?
In terms for gender inequality?
Gender or just, you know, as, you know, being who you are and sort of coming into the company?
Well, yeah, I guess in that sense, yeah, you are initially viewed as the boss's daughter. So you're not really expected to work. But then that quickly goes away because once you start working and people, you do what you're supposed to do and do it well and do it on time. So then people's perceptions automatically change. But that those are just like few and, I mean, initial issues which go away quite quickly. And I think ultimately it's always your work that does the talking. It doesn't matter who you are or what you are. Your work does the talking.
And you've not experienced any with regard to gender? Is there no instance where you felt?
No, in terms of gender biases, I'm fortunate enough, I think, from what I hear, that I've not faced any.
And, you know, Ashni, going to you now, in terms of resistance.
No, I do feel that it's harder. It's definitely harder. I mean, there are enough instances I can, you know, I have enough stories to narrate where I'm perhaps interviewing someone who's from the organization to join a certain team, to join a certain position, and all he can comment on is the way I dress. Or, you know, so when I'm like fully pregnant and I'm in a boardroom, people look at me saying, why are you really here? Please go home. So there are enough such instances, but I think it's a choice we make as well, right? I think it's our individual choice and it's in our hands to fight it in our own ways. And each of us have done that in many ways. I think our mothers did it in their own times and maybe in different scenarios. And but I think we've come a long way and we definitely are far more privileged than the world outside. Yeah, or even the generation before.
And, you know, speaking about, you know, your father, you know, how much has he actually influenced your business decisions and your sort of way of doing business?
Of course, there is a huge influence. There's no doubt about that. But I think also over time, since I've also been in the company for a long time, you generally also what happens in advertising and our sort of a field, it's a young person's business. And we're always open to new ideas and new suggestions. At Madison, in fact, you know, we take quite a lot of pride in saying that we are quite an entrepreneurial company, not just from our perspective, but even from our employees' perspective. And we encourage everyone to come up with their own new radical ideas and bring them forward, and we try to implement them.
So I think, you know, my father has always been my brain trust, whether it's on professional things or personal things. But now I see that, you know, we may have differences of opinions and we agree to disagree. And in my phase of my work, I do what I think is best. And we come together when we have to. So it's a two-way thing. And I don't think he's the source of everything that is created at the Future Group. And there's a deep respect and there's a deep inspiration one can draw out of it every day.
And Amira, would you say that your style of leadership is very different to your father's, or would you say you have been influenced by his business?
I've been influenced by him personally a lot, as a father, as an individual. But we worked together for very few years. We worked together only for 3 years together, where he brought sort of the technical, scientific strength to the table, because he's a doctor. And I brought all the business trends to the table. So it was very complementary. We worked together initially quite a lot. But since 2004, he's not really been involved. He's been non-exec. But I think the 2-3 things that I took away from him, I don't know whether as a person or in leadership, but I think which are very important values, is that there's no politics. He's very, very straightforward. What you see is what you get. And I think that's been my style as well. In what I've imbibed, whether in my close relationships or at work. I think secondly, the idea of not being too much in control. I think again, he was very somebody who gave a lot of sort of delegation to everybody. He was never a micromanager. And I think he and I have a similar trait there, where I'm very happy to build a team and delegate and assign responsibility and let other people be better than I am. And have better ideas and be able to contribute better to the organization. So I think these were the two things that I've picked up from him, I would say, just even as a father.
And so it's one thing to be influenced and, you know, inspired by your fathers, but what do you think, you know, what would you say your fathers actually admire about you? So, you know, we could start with Ashni. And
I hope there are many things, but I think just my ability to go into any subject or any context and find the depth, find deeper meaning and find the source of why things are the way they are, perhaps is something that he could, you know, find in me. And I hope, and you know, for us, our relationship has been very reciprocal. It's been very, like, we're not like father-daughter. We almost talk like equals sometimes, and, you know, the customer decides who wins.
Moving forward to Lara.
I'm not so sure, but maybe a whole different perspective on the way he would look at things. So that's one, and I think he knows that if I'm involved in something, I'll do a thorough job, and I'm hardworking, and, you know, at least he can delegate some things to me, and they'll be done.
So he trusts
but you'll
you.
Have to ask yeah. him.
All right, and Amira?
Actually, he shared this with me last year, or just last year, actually, where I had a big shareholding challenge in my organization for many years, almost for 10 years, and it was causing a lot of damage in the business. It was destroying value in the business. And I just sort of decided in 2014 that I wasn't going to live with it. And either I was going to take huge risks and transform it, or I was going to lose in the bargain. And I was willing to bear the consequences of that. And what it landed up meaning was that I landed up taking a huge risk. And fortunately for us, for me and for him, it landed up paying off well. But I remember him telling me that the ability with which you've had the vision, taken the risk, and built this business, I would have never been able to do. And that was a huge compliment, because I respect him for all the things that he's so capable at, that I think that compliment was very well.
And so now, you know, as women, you've already sort of touched on it, but, you know, as you said, there have been instances where people have sort of undermined your capability. And so, you know, how did you deal with those situations? What do you do then? Do you sort of tell them off? Do you kind of subtly, you know, show them that you're capable? How do you actually practically deal with something like that?
So, like Ashni said very rightly, I think while it's good to acknowledge that these things exist, the sexism exists, or people have their own biases of different things, I think it cannot be an obstacle, or it can't become an excuse. And I think we have to find our way through it. For me, you know, sometimes you're with customers, and a customer will be inappropriate. And you can't tell the person off. You've got to handle it diplomatically so that you don't lose your business and you still manage to get on with it. So I think you learn your way in different situations. Sometimes it means drawing a very hard boundary. Sometimes it means being more diplomatic. Sometimes it's humor. Sometimes it's actually just tackling the situation with humor and disregarding it and moving on. And sometimes it's about giving analogies and examples which are sort of indirect threats to the person to say, look, watch it. You know, don't step beyond that line. So I think it's about figuring out which one works for which person. You need to have multiple types of ways of dealing with it. And then depending on who you're with, I think you have to adapt.
And Ashni, if you could, you know, share some instance where your capability was sort of undermined and how you dealt with it.
Yeah, so, I mean, you know, in the beginning, people are also surprised to see you in meetings, the fact that you make it to work at 9 every morning. So you have to go get past that. I think the sooner we stop addressing it in our heads, the sooner people stop looking at us from those lenses as well. And that's when perhaps, like, you know, what Lara said, like, your work just has to take over. I think that's one way to deal with it. But, you know, to be honest, in my younger days, I've cried, I've howled, I've done all kinds of things like that. But maybe today, I've, you know, maybe there's experience, maybe there's enough proven about my capabilities and ability that one is you know, in this place, being able to talk in a more positive way. I think, but there's only one way to really battle it. You have to keep at it. There is nothing else that one can do but just keep at it. Sometimes you have to succumb, and at the other times you have to assert. And one has to really play the art of war very, very wisely out there.
And Lara, if you could share.
I think, like I said earlier, your work has to do the talking. And ultimately, people realize, I mean, that you mean business. And, you know, I mean, they can maybe take you for a ride once or undermine you once. But eventually, they will learn. And ultimately, it's your work that always wins.
So, Amira, now you've been actually a big champion of mentorship. And, you know, SheThePeople.tv has been along with you on that journey. So, you know, do you, how important do you actually think mentorship is for young women that are starting out in their, you know, varied careers?
I think mentorship is extremely helpful and useful. As I was telling you earlier, because I didn't grow up in a business family, I didn't have uncles or brothers or cousins, people I could reach out to seek advice from, or women I could seek advice from. And I've only started building my own mentors in the last 3-4 years. And it had to come out of my own relationships that I've had to build. The reason I think it's important to acknowledge and but not allow to become an issue, because there are a lot of young women out there who are facing the same challenges of racism, of sexism, of age, of biases. And a lot of the times when we don't acknowledge it as an issue, they sometimes feel like they're the only ones. And they feel like they are doing something to cause that situation. Like I've actually had, like I mentored at least about 15, 20 women. And so sometimes they'll come and they'll say, oh, you know, this situation happened with me. And what did I do to cause it? And that's a very natural thought process women have. You know, I must have done something wrong. And I think the reason it's important to acknowledge it is to tell them that, look, this is not you alone. This is society. So while it's important for you to understand it and then have the tools to deal with it. But I think mentorship is hugely helpful and important from two points of view. Look, you can get business mentorship, tips on how to do business, how to strategize from anybody. But what I don't think we always keep in mind, especially for women, is the emotional mentorship needed. As you know, we were talking about deep conditioning earlier. Personally, for myself, I can say, and I've seen many other women, where, you know, confidence is not built from a young age. And I always feel that, you know, forget jewelry and forget diamonds and all those things which women have been told are our biggest assets for generations. I think our biggest asset is confidence. And that's the one thing which women are never, that it's never nurtured from a young age. In fact, everything is done to undermine our confidence in subconscious ways, not in an intentional way. So I think the emotional mentorship helps in propping them up, making them believe that they can, making them believe that the dream is not too big. And sometimes the dream is too small, dream bigger. And I think that's where mentorship can play a huge role.
Okay. And, you know, Ashni, so you actually work with your sister as well. So how do you draw strength from each other? You know, what is that dynamic like?
She's very different than me. And I think that's really useful because she's to the point, she's rude, she's blunt, but she gets work done like no one else. So, you know, sometimes it's useful to have that perspective as well in your life to balance things out otherwise. So she's very to the point and all she cares about is business. So she just goes and attacks. I think it's because of the difference in our approaches that we find strength in each other.
And, you know, Lara, of course, you had big shoes to fill in terms of, you know, your father being, you know, this big stalwart in the whole media industry and having so much respect. So, you know, did you ever feel the pressure or did you ever think that, you know, this is really hard and challenging to kind of live up to that name?
So I don't look at it like I have to fill in my father's shoes. I am my own person and I have my own role to play. So I'm not really in competition with him or trying to be like him because I know I cannot be. So I just focus on what I have to do and the task given to me and my job and don't let all these other things bog me down. So focus on the now and the present.
So, you know, I was, you know, if you've read the book Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg, you know, she talks about how we have educated women who, you know, eventually at some point kind of take a step back from their careers because, you know, they get married and they have children. And then that becomes a problem because, you know, we're losing all these women from the workforce. So have you experienced that in your companies? And, you know, what can, you know, what have you done to sort of encourage women to, you know, stay on or to create, you know, processes where it helps them to kind of get that flexibility where they can sort of not quit, you know, their careers, but still balance everything out in their lives?
So I think, first of all, such issues are more internal. Like, I also have a small baby. And, I mean, taking care of my child is my responsibility, and I have to manage internally within my family and get a support system to, you know, make sure that the baby is fine when I am at work. So I genuinely feel, rather than look at outwards for such things, you need to look inwards. Having said that, at Madison, we don't have a very structured policy in place, but we are flexible for people who are, for mothers who have recently delivered, in terms of either extended leave or flexi working hours. We are also limited in what we can do because we are a service organization and we have to deal with clients on a day-to-day basis. So we don't have like a, you know, a product to offer. And so that in that sense, we are limited in the sort of things that we can do.
Ashni, you know, is there something that you'd like to add to that?
I think actually in India, we are the most fortunate where this is concerned. I too have a baby, and I think luckily, thanks to the Nani Dadi ecosystem and the entire entourage available to us, bringing up a child is much easier in India at large. What we need to fight is perhaps our own mindset, perhaps societal mindset, but that's going to be a journey. That's not going to go away today or tomorrow. And our guilt, you're right. So I think we are very fortunate in India, and we have a very closer community ecosystem, a family ecosystem that we should and we do lean into to make things work. I think at Future Group, we are very, very alert on this front, to be honest. We have various dreams, like to only have a women-run store, to have store managers who are women, despite all these crazy hours, etc. I think we do things in structured and unstructured way. I think our policies have also kept pace. India has, I mean, got good progressive laws for women, supporting women. We should celebrate that as well. And beyond that, we just should be human, I think. You know, as an organization, many of our leaders, you know, go through many programs where small nuances like this are understood by them. And just, if one is human, then whether it's man or woman, the context is understood, and then decisions can be made.
I think when you're trying to change something in society, there has to be an extra effort, otherwise it doesn't happen automatically. And, you know, I remember, so we take this, and it's been a personal sort of very thing close to my heart, where at least in Metropolis, what we've done is we've created policies specifically to support women when they're going through their difficulties, in whichever way. Because she's right, while the Nani Dadi network is extremely helpful, some families don't have that benefit. Some families have traveled from different locations, they've resettled, they don't have the extended family support. And unless you make those suggested policies as a serious option for them, a lot of the times they make choices which are easy at that time, which sometimes means giving up their career as a trade-off for taking care of their child, even though they would like to do both. What was surprising to me was that just a couple of years ago, we moved offices, and I told my guys, I said, look, you know, now in the new office, create a creche. And so that women who are able to bring their young babies. And I said, look, but before you do it, do a little poll. And so they did a little poll in the office. And, you know, how many of you would like this? And out of a few hundred people that had been polled, the answer came back that only one person wanted the creche. So I was really surprised. I was like, what's going on? You know, I thought we were doing something which is progressive. And the reason when we went into it was most women said, I travel by train and bus. How am I going to bring my six-month baby to work? It's just not even an option for me, right? So something which seemed like a good idea theoretically
was just so impractical to even do, just because it didn't work for them. But there are many other policies that do work, and we've actually put them in Metropolis, and even today we have 55% of our workforce is women.
That's amazing. So, you know, what advice would you actually want to give your younger self? If you could go back in time and, you know, advise yourself when you were starting out, what advice would you give yourself?
God, that's a laundry list. That's a really long list. I've done lots of wrong things, made lots of mistakes, had lots of failures. But I would say probably I've always been in a hurry. And, you know, there's always been this sense of, you know, I've got to build quickly, I've got to grow fast, I've got to do this, I've got to do that. And I think if you look at things from a slightly longer perspective, and from a slightly more long-term, many number of years rather than a shorter-term perspective, sometimes the decisions that are made can be more substantial, can be wiser, and not so short-term. Because the short-term ones usually come back to bite you at some point.
Ashti?
So, you know, my sister gives me the advice, you know, and she's like, just chill, relax. And, you know, I would perhaps tell myself the same thing, like go on more vacations. If I was younger, I should have perhaps done that. But otherwise, you know, what I would tell other young people is keep failing so that you can succeed one day. I mean, and the sooner you fail, the sooner you're going to succeed. So keep walking, keep failing, you'll get there.
Lara, your advice to your younger self?
I think I wish I had worked somewhere else in another company, maybe in India or abroad, before I started working in Madison. I think that experience would have been invaluable to me, but maybe in another lifetime.
Fair enough. So now, you know, we want to have an interactive session, so we actually want to open the floor to questions, and I see a lot of hands up. So if we could get mics passed around, if there are any.
Can I?
Okay, so we'll take that one first then.
Okay, I just want to know, in your own eyes, do you think you have done anything differently from, say, the sons of the family would have done? You did say that gender did not come in the way. That's very nice. But instead of you, had it been the son, do you think things would have been different? They would have taken different decisions or looked at things differently.
Do you want to address this to
all
everyone?
All the three of them. Okay.
Yeah. So your question is that if I had been a son instead of a daughter, or had there been another son along with me, a brother, would have anything been different? 100% not. You know, the likelihood, my parents have always been very progressive. There's never been this sense of, I'll treat my son differently, I'll treat my daughter differently. We were only two girls, but even if there were three boys, there would have been no difference at all. So, yeah, zero.
I feel quite similarly, actually. I mean, it's two girls and, you know, we have a lot of feminine force and shakti in our family and we rule in that. I mean, I think my father would be very lost. In fact, I remember when I got married, we were like telling my father, okay, you get speed up, like, you know, you should know about cars, you should know about like other things like that as well. Come on.
So we are just two sisters, but I think if he had a brother, he would be at a disadvantage.
So what's your thought on superwoman conflict?
Superwoman?
Superwoman conflict, like women should do it all.
Whatever we say is going to be controversial here, right? Look, I disagree fundamentally with this idea of having it all, first of all, whether it's men or women. Because this idea of having it all is a very standard definition, which means two children, white picket fence, husband or wife, thriving career, perfect home, great, you know, hostess. That seems to be the definition of having it all. And I disagree with that definition fundamentally. To me, having it all means the flexibility in life to be able to make choices as I evolve. That's what it means to me.
That means I have the financial security, the emotional security, and the physical security of being able to make different choices for myself as my life keeps changing. And in that situation, I believe any person, man, woman, can have it all.
Good afternoon. Yes, my question is to Lara. I've been trying to sell advertisement space on Twitter. Can you guide me?
Sure, we can talk offline.
Thank you so much.
Good evening. Okay. I'm here.
Hi.
My name is Imran Merchant, Bombay-based writer and journalist. My question basically is directed to Lara Balsara with a small preface. That when I was part years ago of the Sterling Magazines group, I happen to know your dad on personal terms and professionally quite well. You know, we used to know him as good old Sam in the industry. So my question is, with the other two ladies can also weigh in on this. It's a very justified question with a personal touch in this. Is making the money in your business the only thing that is your motivational factor? And I frame this question in the context of, when I learned in the big election scenario of May 2014, the victory of the BJP and the RSS, in that sense, that medicine was one of the important advertising the companies that were also supporting those particular efforts, the big media, big gigantic effort of the right-wing groups of supporting that. So do you think that I'm right in assuming that Sam Balsara and his medicine had actually supported that campaign? And do you think, in your view, that was justified as a business proposition to do that?
Okay, so for your first, one of your questions was if we focus more on, is making money more important than what we, than medicine itself?
Raking the moolah at any cost.
No, that's, first of all, okay, let me answer your question on the BJP. In anything in life, everything is about strategy. So for the BJP campaign, we had come out with a very good and a clear strategy that this is what we will do, these are the markets that we would address. And we went full whole hog based on that strategy. So we spent a fraction of the, BJP rather spent a fraction of the money that's actually reported as what they spent. And the whole campaign did really well for them. But to be honest, they spent a fraction of what was reported in the media. So everything is about strategy and targeting and focusing on what your key markets are.
Okay. Just one final observation.
Yes.
We do know, I take your point, but we do know that medicine was not one of the only agencies or corporates that were involved in this. There were many other, host of others also.
Yes, of course, there were many others, so there's no denying that.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Moving on to...
Yeah. This is for Amira also, and maybe the other two ladies also. Having known Dr. Sushil Shah professionally for around about 2 decades, I'm very happy to see you have the same levels of energy, passion, and leadership skills which you demonstrated. But somewhere in the entire theme, I couldn't understand what each one of you picked up from your mothers, which has helped you take to the next level of leadership, as well as heights of your respective organizations.
I think, as I was saying, I think till 2001, so my father had been running his pathology lab from 1981 to 2001. And he was, he was not only a doctor, he was a doctor entrepreneur. It was very unusual, because at that time he had been asked, while he had his own lab, he had been asked to be the pathologist also at 3 hospitals, HN, Breach Candy, SIFI, multiple hospitals. And what happens normally is they ask a pathologist, they pay them some compensation monthly, and they are supposed to run the path lab. And all three at the time were not doing well. So he was entrepreneurial enough to talk to the managements in all three and tell them that, look, I will not take any fixed salary. I will run this pathology laboratory. And if you're happy with the way it's growing, you pay me a percentage of it. Now, this is very unusual for most doctors. They never take this kind of thought process forward. So there was always the entrepreneurial bug in him. I think in 2001, what he did exceptionally well was the fact that he understood what doctors needed. He understood latest technologies because he had got trained in Cornell and come back. He was the first one to introduce HIV testing in India. He was the first one to introduce IVF testing for, you know, a lot of the people who are talking about having children. He was the first one to introduce many varieties of tests, and even today we continue to be pioneers. But what most doctor practices don't have is the ability to scale, because doctor practices are usually about the individual. They're about that one person who's sitting and managing their time, right? You'll see most doctors are working 10, 12 hours a day. What I was able to bring to the table was to say, how can we take this beyond the individual, beyond the man, and how can we make it into a brand? How can we make it into an organization? And how we scaled from there was I said that, look, the same way my father has built for 20 years his pathology lab in Bombay, in South Bombay, and had grown his good reputation there, there are many other pathologists like him who have done things in the right way with good quality in other cities of the country. So why can't I build an indigenous path lab chain, bringing together all these pathologists who have good reputation in their own cities, like my father has in Bombay, somebody else in Chennai, somebody else in Bangalore, and put it under a brand name of Metropolis. And that was the vision.
She was about their mothers, right? Yeah, well, how
oh,
did your
I'm
mother,
sorry.
Yeah, how
sorry,
did your
sorry.
Mom
I
actually,
clear your
yeah, well, how did your mom
your
influence
question was about
you?
My mom, influencing. Yeah. Oh, so sorry. I think from my mom, she's by the way also a gynecologist and OBGYN, Dr. Durusha. And I have never met anybody more hardworking, more conscientious, and who's so invested in her patients' care as her. So I think for me, what I've picked up from her are those things of, like she said, just keep going at it, you know, the hard work that's needed. And again, I think the idea of doing things in the right way, not taking shortcuts, not trying to scam people, but always doing something with a full heart and a full investment.
Ashni and Lara, as well.
I think a lot. I mean, you know, we obviously, you're right, we speak more about what we learned from our fathers, but I think from my mother, I just learned how to do multiple things and you know, she instilled the sense of confidence that you can do this, that, and the other. And, you know, that is enough to take away in some sense. I mean, she's what makes my world go round, right, left, everything. So, lots.
I think I would say family, culture, values, putting family ahead of everything else. So those are some of the things that I've learned from my mother.
We had a question in the back.
My question is to all three of you. Recently, Indra Nui in one of her interviews mentioned that as she reached to the top, she had to compromise the role of a mother or being a wife. So do you agree with it? Do you feel anywhere you have compromised your role being a mother or your wife at any point of your time?
I think life is always about compromise. You always feel, you know, you always have to give some, you lose some. And at least being a mother, there's always this sense of guilt because you obviously want to spend the entire day with your child, and when you leave for work and she's crying, it's not a very nice feeling, but such is life.
Ashni, would you like to answer that?
I agree. I think we all have to learn to compromise. We all have to learn to prioritize at different times, different things. So there is always this tussle in our minds, in our hearts, that is continuous, and I think resolving it every day is where we feel very victorious at the end of it.
I think the what kills us, or what kills any of us for anything that we're trying to balance multiple balls in the air, is the need for perfection. And I think as soon as we drop this need for perfection in any aspect of our lives, be it work or as a mom or as a wife or as a daughter, as anything, then I think life becomes a little bit easier because you're not trying to be, you know, perfect daughter or the perfect mother or the perfect whatever. And I think that quest for perfection is actually what causes a lot of anxiety and a lot of doubt in a lot of us. So,
do we have any questions? Yeah.
Would it be right to say that all of you obviously started off in a more privileged position than many other common women in this country? Have any of you ever thought, or all of you, or any of you would like to do something to change the laws in this country towards women. The Company Act recently has made it mandatory to have at least one woman director on the board of companies, but till then, till that had happened, you know, it was a very male-dominated area. Laws towards women's safety, molestation, any kind of criminal acts doesn't get sorted in this country. Since some of you women are in a very privileged position, would you think that you would be able to do something to bring about a change, not just in society, but in laws in this country, which favor yourselves? Have you ever given it a thought?
So, look, I think each of us have to pursue a purpose that is close to our heart.
Which is business?
Not for me. Mm-hmm. While business is close to my heart because it's like my child, Metropolis is, but doesn't mean that's the purpose of life. For me, my purpose that's close to my heart is what we were talking about earlier, that I think there is a huge opportunity for women to follow their dreams in this country. And I think there's a lot of obstacles that come along the way, whatever your dream is. My goal at least is to keep giving back, to see if there's some way that I can help them achieve, get closer to their dreams. And to me, that's what's close to me, so I do that. I don't know about the legal part, if there was anybody who wants to comment on that.
I actually think that we are we have too many laws in this country. I think we need to follow them, or we need to make sure they are enforced. So I don't think adding laws is going to be much of a solution, maybe changing them, etc., maybe. But I agree more to what Amira said. I mean, I think we need to sort it out in smaller ways, in more cohorts, through more mentor models, through our family ecosystems. Maybe that's another way to go as well.
Lara, do you have anything to add to this question? All right. So we have time for just one last question. I think
Hi. So as girls, we've been conditioned to sort of, you know, not be Miss Bossy Pants, you know, while growing up. I want to ask a question in today's day and age. How do you balance being a nice person, but also sort of getting your way done without being, you know, hated by the guys or being called names by, you know, your colleagues? So how do you get that balance between being a good person? You don't have to be mean, but by getting stuff done, you know, confidently.
I can speak for myself and say that I think we actually create too many differences in our professional life and personal life. And I don't think there needs to be. I'm a nice person in my personal life. I'm great to my friends, I'm great to my family, and I'm actually nice to my people at work as well. Because showing emotion doesn't make me weak or doesn't make me in any way, you know, chickish. That means that I can't get my work done. So I can be firm, I can be clear, I can still be emotional. I've cried in front of some of my employees. I've also told them I've loved them. And I can also be clear and firm at the same time. It's about being comfortable in your own skin, right? And not caring too much about the names that people are going to give you, because I can guarantee you one thing, names are always going to be there, whether you're nice or whether you're bossy. And the minute if you're a little bit tough and if somebody calls you bossy pants, then frankly, that's in their brain and not what you're doing. So I just say don't care too much about what people think.
Did anyone else want to add to that? No? So, all right. So I think it's been lovely chatting with you. I hope everyone here has gained value. And I, for one, as a young woman, am really inspired by all of you. So thank you so much for taking your precious time out to chat with us. Thank you.